Okay, we're back. We're live. It's 12 o'clock rock. I'm Jay Fidel. This is ThinkTech. More important, this is Stan the man, Stan the energy man. I don't look like Stan. Well, maybe I do in some ways. But I'm sitting in for Stan Osterman, okay? And Lori McCarney is here. She's from from Bikeshare Hawaii, which is wonderful because we need to talk about that. We need to learn everything about it. We need to get everybody, you know, to understand it, to sympathize with it, to participate. Hi, Lori.
Hi, Jay. How are you? Thank you. Thank you for having me on today.
How'd you get to be the CEO of Bikeshare? That's probably a story right there.
Well, I was actually happily retired, and I'm somebody who wants to make an impact on the city. I don't want to be a politician.
good work.
You know, it's like I don't want to do that. But what kind of skills do I have, and what kind of program could I support to help do that? And this is one I decided to sign up for.
Yeah, what's it like being CEO of Bikeshare?
It is.
Because you're in the rollout mode, so this is more stressful, more demanding than at any other time in the continuum of a business development. No?
Interesting, huh? I've been at this for almost 3 years now, and you know, different phases of funding, of education and outreach, of selecting the equipment provider, working through the technology, understanding the user, understanding the city. Then rolling it out is like, how do you get all these Biki stops out? And then right now we're going through the, what are the issues that we're facing? What are the customers facing? How do we improve those? You know, and just trying to be better all the time.
Yeah, well, you know, you're in a transformational business,
Transforming
a city that doesn't easily transform.
No.
That's one thing about Hawaii. It likes the way things used to be,
right,
not the way things would be. So anyway, yeah, so I mean, I admire you for achieving up to this point what you've achieved, and I sympathize with the fact that it wasn't easy, and I'm, you know, I would love to hear the detail. We don't have enough time for that.
Sure.
Of exactly
how
you mounted
all. Yeah, we'd
have to go have a beer. Yeah, right, the beer. Mounted the challenge of, you know, putting this together, but one challenge is you had to get these bikes on the street. Buying them, it's okay. Publicizing, yeah, you can do that. But how did you get them on the street? There had to be 27 obstacles to get them on the street.
Several obstacles, some of them being, like you said, that people want it the way it was. And actually, if you think about it, this would be the way it was, right?
I agree, absolutely.
And I think that's one of the things about an urban setting is that the urban setting used to be a lot different before the car entered the scene. And so taking it back to what urban settings are, you know, and the things people like to do, living close to where they work and being able to shop at the local retailer and eat and go buy flowers, and you know, and do all of those things without using a car. We're just sort of going back a little further than a lot of people remember. But the obstacles really get to change, you know, and what is it? And it's taking away something that I'm used to, or you know, how do you make that help people understand that? And that's complicated. I think that's one of the bigger things. Working with the city, also, when we're limited in space, it's like, where do you put bike share stations? Where do you put them? And our preference was first, if we had a wide enough sidewalk, because we have to consider ADA, of course, and not block sidewalks.
Oh my goodness.
So we have to make sure we have enough clearance there. And if we couldn't use a sidewalk space, then the next would be a place where parking wasn't allowed. But then you find out a lot of people cockroach that space for other purposes. But to be able to have a place where you weren't taking parking, and then the last place was taking parking. And we've seen the most, you know, actually it's interesting, if it's a business district, sometimes it's those non-parking spaces that are more important to the small businesses because they're using them for loading or unloading or pausing or what have you, versus in a residential district, it's a parking space that somebody's sort of taken as their own, even though it's private property. It's a very interesting type of thing, and I'm a student of people. I like people, and you know, trying to figure out how they work. And
I can see that you would have to have the patience of Job to deal with each, you know, single location and the problems that emerge and the people that may have other designs on that space.
Yeah.
And deal with that and somehow get them all there. And the one I mentioned before the show began was the one that really struck me. It was the one in Kapi'olani Park, which is, let me say, I'll say this in French, it was parfait as a location for bike share. But what happened?
Well, it's interesting, you know, and it's more complicated than I can really talk about, but there is a Kapi'olani Park Trust, and they're interested in protecting the park and the use of the park and what have you. And then there's bike share, and we see bike share and Biki as access to the park. Because I don't know if you know now, if you go to the park, it's very jammed with a lot of cars trying to figure out where to park to get there.
Yeah.
And so we saw that we could be an alternative way for people
to get in. Yeah.
What's happening now, interestingly, is that because we don't have stations in the park, so people will park at the closest they can get.
You mean and with their bikes?
They'll be somewhere. Let's say they're a visitor or a resident, and they want to go enjoy Kapi'olani Park. They really can't, but what they can do is ride around it. So what we're seeing is people who are riding around it because they don't have any place to park a bike share bike. You have to have a Biki stop there to do it. So I think we're missing out on serving a lot of the residents, the people who would say, I'm going to go to Kaimana Beach, or I'm going to go over to the tennis courts. We can't really serve them because there's no place for them to dock a bike.
So bad.
So we'll see.
Lack of understanding.
We'll see. I think
the trust. I'm familiar with the trust. It's, you know, it's to protect Kapi'olani Park.
Right.
But you know, you got to use Kapi'olani Park. The idea is to make it accessible to the public. It's a public space.
Yeah. So from our standpoint, we would like to be able to serve the people in the community so that they can enjoy the park. And so we'll just see how that goes. It's really not our call. And
no. But maybe it'll change later.
Yeah. Maybe.
I mean, if I had an opportunity, I would say to the people involved. Let them put Biki in Kapi'olani Park. That's what I would say.
Yeah.
Anyway, okay, so you got through it, and on July 1st, you opened up with 1,000 bikes in how many locations?
So we're at 89 locations. Those were the Kapi'olani Park ones. Yeah, 89. And I think people thought, boy, it happened so fast. You put them down, then you started, and it happened so fast, and whoa, we were caught by surprise. Well, we tried to do outreach, and it was interesting before to talk to people about bike share, and I don't know how many times I said, do you know what bike share is? It's where you check out a bike at one station, ride it 1 or 2 miles, and check it in. I've probably said that a million times. But I think for most people, until it really appeared, they didn't have an understanding of it. So it didn't really penetrate their brains as far as understanding what it was until we showed up. So for a lot of people, it was a surprise.
Yeah. Yeah. You have to see it. You have to see the stations and see the bikes and see people doing it.
Yeah.
I was telling you that last Saturday I was on 4th Street Mall here, and you have a station there at 4th Street and what is it?
4th Street and Hotel, there's
and
one.
Hotel, yeah. And
very popular station.
A woman was depositing a bike, you know, she was checking it in, and I was curious because, you know, I really care, I mean, I have a lot of care about this. So I started talking to her about it. She was from Switzerland, she was a tourist, she was in Waikiki, she picked up the bike in Waikiki, she drove it downtown, she was going to drive it back again, it was her way of getting around the city, and she had no fear, no obstacle at all, she was completely unhampered in what she was doing. It was what she wanted, what she expected, and certainly what she preferred. And, you know, that's a tourist mentality, a European tourist mentality. But I think we have to achieve that mentality locally, too.
You know, it's interesting because we're all visitors and tourists at some time, right?
Yeah.
And the thing is that people come here from Chicago or New York or Portland or San Francisco. They come here and they're very comfortable, too, because as residents in their community, then they're used to using bike share. And so we were the only top 10 visitor destination without bike share. So when we see people that come in, because there's 60 cities on the mainland, of course, those guys are going to be more used to understanding how to use it because they use it at home as residents.
Yeah.
And so here, we also have a lot of residents that ride, and those are the stories that I like to see. My hairdresser up on King Street or off of King Street, she actually walks from New Uanu down to the station behind the Pali Longs. Uh-huh. And then she uses Biki to get to their salon and parks it nearby. And then she uses it to go to her yoga studio and then come back. And so she uses it that way. And people, there are so many people that want to maybe have one car instead of two or see if they can get by. Those are the people that I really get excited about because we're helping giving them an alternative that's eco-friendly and fun. And I do most of my commuting by Biki.
Of course, this changes our city. This is transformational because once you have a critical mass of people who buy into that, who say, I'll make this part of my life.
Yeah.
I may not, you know, bike everywhere, but I'll bike sometimes and it'll help me out and actually do it. You know, then you're starting to transform, and all the millennials look at you and say, something happening here. This is a real place. It's a walking city. Walking equals walking plus biking.
Right.
You know, I just to go to your point about other cities on the mainland. You know, I was in New York a few months ago, And I noticed right down from the Pan Am building at 42nd Street, uh-huh. you know, it's the most crowded.
Yeah, right.
This is, you know, really a wild place with so many people happening. Grand Central Station is right there, right? Right in front of Grand Central Station, there's a bike share.
A huge one.
Huge one. You know, not many of the bikes were left.
Right.
They were all out.
Yeah.
The system. In New York City, where the traffic is murderous, people, A, the bike guys were not afraid, and B, the traffic was respectful. You have to have both sides of that equation.
You have to have both. And it's interesting, before I took this on, I like going to big cities too, and I went to New York and I saw that. I actually saw a city bike in action. And I thought, how could it work here? The roads are crummy, you know, when you're in Manhattan. You have taxis swerving to the side to pick people up. And I saw bike share working, you know, and I thought, if it can work in Manhattan, why in the heck can't it work in Honolulu?
Amen. It's true. And, you know, I guess the question is, the proposition is that if you have more bikes, biking is safer.
Yes.
If you have more bikes, more people are encouraged to use bikes.
Yes.
It's a self-fulfilling prophecy.
It's a virtuous cycle.
Yeah, a virtuous cycle, yeah. So are we going to have more than 1,000 bikes, and when?
So our idea first is, we've been operating for just over 3 weeks, is get this under our belt.
I want to rush you about
it's like, yeah, well. So we've been operating for about 3 weeks, and we want to take a time to really get urban Honolulu right. Where do we need to fill in stations? Where do we need to adjust some? What are the rider patterns and
easily,
all of that? Yeah, it's not super easy. We need to get big equipment out, but we can move them.
Yeah.
And then really finesse that and really make sure that we know what we're doing really well. And then you say, okay, what other communities can we serve? One of the questions I get big time is, how many residents ride and how many visitors ride? Because everybody assumes it's a visitor amenity. The residents ride if it's in areas where residents live.
Sure, fair enough.
Right? Because really, when you're thinking about a Bikeshare stop, it's not just that Bikeshare stop, it's that entry point into the full network. And you have to have enough of a convenient connection to that to make it work for people.
Yeah.
The reason it works for me is I can use one that's a block away.
Yeah.
If it was much further than that, then I'd probably say it's not convenient.
Yeah.
So in that standpoint, let's get this figured out. Then in 6 months or so, then let's look and see, what are the financial resources? What are the communities that are asking for it? I've gotten calls from communities that are saying, can you come talk to us?
They want Bikeshare on their block.
They think they do, yeah. And but it doesn't necessarily make sense everywhere. You have to have that density of residences, businesses, and attractions. Otherwise, if it's out in the middle of nowhere, you don't have enough people feeding it, and it doesn't make sense for us from an operational side to feed some, you know, try to manage something that's way out in the hinterlands.
Yeah. Oh, so many wonderful decisions. I bet you're collecting data, you're doing analytics, you're trying to do scatter charts and figure out where the best locations are, and then you migrate the stations in that direction, you listen to people, you have your ear to the ground, stethoscope on all day long. Yeah.
Exactly. It's early to do that, but you know, you start saying, well, here's a station that's not doing very well. How come? It's only a block or a block and a half away. And you start to learn, like real estate, location, you know, it's how far will people go for something.
Sure.
But we also want to have stations close together so that if we do have a situation where one is full, you know, you show up with your bike and the station's full, you need to have one close by sort of as a backup so that people don't say, well, this isn't going to work for me. So there's a lot of different things that are involved, but it is fascinating.
What about baskets?
So there is a basket on the front. It's a bungee and a basket.
Oh, okay. I didn't notice that.
Yeah.
Got a basket.
Yeah. And so I looked at closed basket, you know, like a regular wire type basket, because I thought, well, personally, I thought that might be easier. And then what I realized was a couple of things. One is it can't hold odd-sized things, and they might bounce out.
Yeah.
And the other one is that it's just a garbage collector. It's very convenient to put your trash in a basket as you walk by. So for those two reasons.
You mean a pedestrian?
Yeah,
oh, that would be so foul.
Yeah, as I was
that.
Looking at other cities, I was seeing that's one of the issues that they deal with. So, but this basket works really well. I can carry my laptop and my bag, and I see people carrying all sorts of different things in it. A funny story, I heard somebody talking about, they went to get plate lunch. And because it's sort of this shape, a plate lunch wouldn't necessarily work in there because it would leak out, you know, where it folds over. And so this one place they go to now, they'll say, I need a Bikeshare pack. And so then they'll pack up the plate lunch in a container that will work to go in that way. So I thought that was a pretty cool story.
It's Lauren McCarney. She's the CEO of Bikeshare Hawaii, fabulous organization, which I believe will change and transform our community, is already changing and transforming our community. And when we come back from this break, I want to talk to Lori about, you know, when she has time to take a breath after this really incredible startup here on July 1st, and where she should go when she has the time. And the answer will be very interesting. The answer, and I'll explain why later, will be China. Okay? We'll be right back with Lori McCarney.
Living in this crazy world, so caught up in the confusion, nothing is making sense for me and you. Maybe we can find a way, there's got to be a solution. How to make a brighter day, what do we do? We've got to give a little love, have a little hope, make this world a little better.
Aloha, my name is Raya Salter, and I am the host of Power Up Hawaii, which you can see live at from 1 to 1:30 every Tuesday at thinktechhawaii.com and then later on YouTube. I am an energy attorney, clean energy advocate, and community outreach specialist. And on Power Up Hawaii, we come together to talk about how can Hawaii walk towards a clean, renewable, and just energy future. To do that, we talk to stakeholders all over the spectrum, from clean energy technology folks to community groups, to politicians, to regulators, to the utility. So please join us Tuesdays at 1 o'clock for Power Up Hawaii.
Okay, we're back, we're live. Wow, this is a great discussion. Lori McCarney, thank you so much for coming down, yeah?
Thank you.
All right, we're talking about Bikeshare, the new way of getting around, the new way of attracting people to get around, the new human scale city, that's what we're mm-hmm. building here.
Yeah.
You know, and this is connected, in my view, with option 2A in the rail, mm-hmm. that is going at grade, because if you go at grade, then you can, you know, you can pave in the streets downtown. Mm-hmm. You can put grass in the middle of Bishop Street. You can have bikes and connecting with rail at grade. I mean, it's a beautiful picture. It's European. It's out of some of the wonderful cities in France. And, well, maybe one day, you know, street corner cafes. You see it?
Love street corner cafes.
Anyway, China. That's where I think you need to go on your first vacation, should you ever have another one. And that means you should look at OFO, and you are familiar with
OFO
the other.
OFO and Mobike and some of the other ones. Yeah. And there are some U.S. companies trying the same thing.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah.
In the U.S.?
In the U.S., yeah. Most cities have not sort of figured out how to use them or if it's going to make sense in their city. And it's the interesting idea of saying, let's create excess capacity in bikes by putting a bunch of bikes on the street and then letting people use apps to use them. So it's like the idea of Uber, which people have excess capacity with their cars, and then you can access that excess capacity with an app. But since there isn't that with bikes, then it's like create that and then use the apps to access it. It's a very interesting idea. I was thinking about that for Honolulu. It wasn't at the time when we were making our selection, but there were things along that path. Yeah. And one of the things I know in Honolulu was a couple of things. One was, we like things a little neat and tidy, and we like to know the expectation of that's where the bike's going to be. Also, we have communities, the neat and tidy place. And then also, between the resident and visitor use, as you get to some of these other kinds of things that are app related, not everybody wants to use an app to use a bike. And so I know when I've been in
some
other countries,
yeah.
I've gotten to places, Sweden being one, and Germany being another place, where they're not really geared to any visitors at all. And so you have to have the app, you have to be able to be part of their transit system and everything to get it. And it sort of excludes some people. And for us, we believe that visitors, I mean, we're a community of visitors and residents, and we really wanted to be able to serve everybody.
You should have great support from the visitor industry as an industry, because you give visitors another opportunity to see the city, see us where we live. You know, all this talk about the people in Hawaii, well, they never get out of Waikiki, they can't possibly
right.
appreciate it. But if you get on the street a little bit and ride.
And people, even residents, one of the first people said, I feel like I have a whole new city to explore now.
Isn't that true? You know, I rode bike, I told you I raced bike way back when, and I rode everywhere, not only in Oahu, but every island, mm-hmm. all the highways and byways. And I got to know the city so well, so fast. It's not just the roads either.
Right.
It's the whole lifestyle of people around us, what they do, how they engage. You know, you get a whole different bird's eye, close-up view of what our state, our city is like if you're riding a bike.
I'm enjoying commuting now. So I commute by Bikeshare, and I used to commute my car because it was too far to walk, frankly, and so the option was a car. And now I find our offices are right near Ward and Ala Moana, and I live downtown, so it takes me about 8 minutes to get in by Beaky. But at that time, then I see a lot more, I actually associate more with people, too. When you're in a car and you're all in that air-conditioned loveliness with your radio on and stuff, you're totally isolated. Yeah. When you're out there, people wave or say hi, or there goes a beaky, or, you know, you really, you make eye contact with people, and I think that's one of the things we're not doing enough with anymore, is being connected to our fellow man.
Yeah, we've been waiting for decades to get to this, really, and that's why it's very important.
We used to be, you know, and I think that's the thing, we used to be like that, and with so many things that are seem to be pulling us apart, why not take the opportunity to remember that we're all people again?
Yeah.
And that's one of the things I'm enjoying and hearing people talk about, that connection with people.
So what about come on your rates, $3.50 a half an hour, that's a little steep.
Yeah, don't pay that.
How do you, oh, you buy a package.
Go online to gobiki.org or on the app, and then you buy a package. And the package, there's thinking about how you might ride. If you're not sure how you're going to use it, then get the free Spirit Pass, $20, prepaid 300 minutes, works out to 6.7 cents a minute. And it's just use it, you know, you just pay as you go, basically. So if my rides are 8 minutes, then that's 8 times 6.7, whatever that is. But it's, you know, about 50 cents or whatever for a ride. The minutes never expire, so I can just use it spontaneously as the need arises.
Okay, so if you're riding 6 minutes, then you just, and when you put the bike into another stand, it stops.
It stops. The clock stops. You pull it out, it starts, and then you see the green light when you pull the bike out. That means when it starts, and when you put seeing the green light when you check it in, that's when it stops.
Then you can
see how it you can see how many minutes you've used and what happens.
Is this comparable with other cities?
I mean, this is a new one for us. I realized that the other plans that we have are more like that, but I thought, how do we reach people who aren't going to be consistent users?
Yeah, right.
How do we make it affordable for them? Right. So it's more of a spur of the moment, or right now I need a way to get somewhere, or I'm just going to use it occasionally. That's what this plan was for.
So how do you see this evolving going forward? I mean, I would like to see more bikes, more stations. I would like to see, I don't know, what would I like to see, Lori? You must know.
What I would like to see is more riders. We have a lot of ridership right now. We're already at over 36,000 Beaky trips.
Who have come on the website and
no, that have made a trip, so we can count how many times it's been used. And then we're tracking different stations to see how that goes. But my objective has always been to make it accessible and for it to work for as many kinds of people as possible.
How do you adjust the number of bikes in one station against another? I mean, that'd be a problem in China, too. In China, they monitor everything with GPS.
Right.
And they get people, you know, come down the street and pick them up where they bunched over here, and they take them back over there, and the whole thing is equalized.
We do that. That's what we do. It's called rebalancing, is what they call it in the industry.
Yeah.
So right now, I could go to my computer and see what the status of every single station is, and you'll see the Beaky van out, and what its job is to move bikes around. So when we see there's a station full or almost full, you got to pull bikes out. You see one that's empty, you got to put bikes in. We're trying to figure out patterns so we can anticipate that better, but because we're still new, we're still figuring out what those patterns are. There's a big thing going on at the convention center. They gave us a heads up about that. So we know that we're actively servicing that right now because we want to make sure that we're serving the people where they need it.
There's something really touching about a Bikeshare bike, truck. Going down the street. I hope you have a big sign on the side. It says Bikeshare bike.
It does.
You know, and people cheer. You know, hey, Bikeshare bike.
See the that would be nice. They do cheer on the bikes. I think that's what's fun. And we wanted the guy who's running our operations wants to change the horn on the Bikeshare van to a ding ding ding.
like the ice cream.
Yeah,
truck
or it's
years
more
ago.
Like a bike bell. Yeah. So we are a people business. I think that's one of the things. You know, we have a call center here. We have local people in a call center from 6 a.m. to 11 p.m. 7 days a week.
Yeah.
Because we want people to have a good experience.
Why would I call?
So you might get to a doc and say, I can't figure out how this works, or I have a question about this, or I can't get the bike in, or I don't know how to adjust the seat.
Fair
or
enough.
It could be any kind of question.
Okay, I want to ask you one last question in our remaining time, which is not all that much. And that is, part of making bikes work, at least in Honolulu, and there are similar issues on the neighbor islands, but part of what you need is streets that are comfortable to ride on.
Absolutely.
And that means bike lanes.
Yeah.
And it, in my view, this is my own personal view, it does not mean sharrows. Mm-hmm. Sharrow is a punt. Mm-hmm. You know, and I'm thinking, for example, I rode down McCulley Street. Mm-hmm. You go down McCulley Street, and one block there's a bike lane. Next right. block is a sharrow.
Right.
What? And then I got to get out of the bike lane, right in front of the cars. I got to navigate in front of the cars, who may not understand where the sharrow is.
Right.
Okay. And then the next block, I'm back in a bike lane. I say, this is really, I mean, it's, maybe it costs the city less, but it is not a good and safe solution. And so, you know, we have block by block an enormous job to do to make this a truly bike-friendly city.
Totally.
So although it's nice to have the bikes available, it's nice to have more riders, in order to move this ahead, you know, to make that, what did you call it?
Virtuous cycle.
Virtuous cycle to
yeah.
complete,
yeah.
you know, somebody has to fix the streets. I mean, potholes is one small thing. It's the whole design of the streets and the bike lanes and the interaction. You know, if I do King Street without doing the verticals, I mean, the north-south, Malcolm
right.
Mackay, you know, what am I doing? I just one lane for a mile. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
It needs to be everywhere. So, I mean, of course we agree.
Yeah.
But the question is, and this is really important, you know, HBL, to mm-hmm. a limited degree, tries to do lobbying and political action in the city and mm-hmm. to some extent the state.
Sure.
And here's the thing. You are in an excellent position, an excellent, at least as good a position, because you're a commercial enterprise, not just a, you know, a recreational association. You're a commercial nonprofit, I think.
Right, we are a nonprofit.
But you're still a commercial
still,
organization
right.
and you have, you know, you have commercial activity happening within your business, so to speak. You have potentially tremendous clout to go to the city and say, you've got to make this place more bike friendly. I know it's early for that, but
well,
I wonder what you think about that.
I totally agree. I think what we have is not a commercial activity, but what we have is more people. I think the city has the desire to do more bike infrastructure. There's a bike plan to do it, and it's not that expensive. It's really that this same kind of thing that we're faced with, which is pushback and non-acceptance of it. The idea that why would I give up a lane, a traffic lane, for a bike lane? And so the more people that are actually biking and they see more people biking and they experience it themselves, they're more likely to be supportive of then having a safer place to ride. And I think that's where, you know, trying to get to that tipping point where there's enough people that every time the city tries to do something, you know, that, you know, they have 2 million people come out against it. You know, is trying to get that balance there where people say, well, wait a minute, you know, I actually use Beaky a couple of times. I'm comfortable on South Street and King Street, but I really want to be able to get around. I need more safe places to ride. You tell me I can't ride on the sidewalk. You want me to ride in the street. So I'm uncomfortable doing that. I have a personal mission to have more women riding because okay. I think that's something that women think for whatever reason, this bike share is not for them in other cities, but that's why I got a smaller bike. And that's why I also think that the idea of safety is more, it sounds funny, but it's a bigger issue for women than it is for men. And so that's where my reason even for doing this, the passion for bike share is not about bike share at the end, it's about transforming the city. And that big part of it is the bike infrastructure and all those connections. And you know, HBL is one of our greatest partners. And the city is too. I think we all have a similar vision of what we're trying to accomplish here, and we all have different strengths to bring to the table.
The law of the broken paddle.
Yeah.
We all have a right to the streets. You heard that before. Thank you, Lori.
Thank you.
To have you here, and we have to talk to you again and again and follow this wonderful journey, this adventure that you've started.
Thank you. Thank
Thanks
you very
for doing
much.
That. Aloha.
Aloha.